For ages, we looked up to the sky and wondered about our place amongst the stars. Once an object of wonder, today, the moon is the blueprint for our next big leap. But instead of going to the moon and coming back, this time, we're going to stay.
But to stay, we're gonna need a lunar base. And what exactly is a lunar base?
Well, a lunar base is a permanent, human-operated facility on the moon designed to be self-sustaining.
But it's not just one piece of tech. It's a combination of systems. Rocketry, life support, power, mining, mapping, all working together to make life on the moon possible.
Welcome to our deep dive into the technology of lunar bases.
15 seconds. Guidance is internal. 12, 11, 10, 9. Ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. All engine running. Liftoff. We have a liftoff. 32 minutes past the hour. Liftoff.
Let's start with rocketry. A four-person crew needs upwards of 300 kilograms of consumables for a two-week mission. But the biggest weight isn't food or gear, it's fuel. And since fuel makes up most of the mass, it also makes up most of the cost. While the cost of sending payloads to lower Earth orbit has decreased over time, breakthrough technologies and more frequent missions may be necessary to lower the costs of sending payloads to the moon, which will be essential to the growth of any future lunar base. And the key to this may lie in reusability. But once we get payloads like this to the moon, how will we land them? That part's still tricky. The surface is covered in razor-sharp dust and rocks called regolith, which can rip holes through the lander, base, and even orbital satellites. That's why landing tech matters. We need safe landing pads to mitigate the damage of regolith, which a lunar lander may eject at speeds as high as 900 meters per second, the same speed as a bullet. Landing infrastructure helps reduce the amount of regolith ejected, how far it travels, and how many systems are exposed to it.
But once we have landed, how do we survive on the moon? Building reliable life support systems that can handle the moon's harsh environment is one of the biggest engineering challenges. Also, depending on the location, the moon can reach temperatures hot enough to boil water and cold enough to begin to freeze the very air that we breathe on Earth. So we need systems that can insulate, regulate, and adapt, keeping habitats stable no matter the extremes. And to keep these systems running, we need power.
A lunar base needs to generate, store, and manage its own energy without help from Earth. The main source, solar panels, potentially made with lunar regolith turned into moon glass. That means much of the solar infrastructure could be built directly on the moon. But when the sun disappears for up to 2 weeks during a lunar night, we'll need serious battery storage and smart energy systems to survive. That's where regenerative fuel cells come in. During the day, when surplus power is available through solar panels, they split water into hydrogen and oxygen. During the long lunar night, they use that very same hydrogen and oxygen as an energy source to produce water, provide power for the base, and add supplemental heat for insulation.
But before we build on the moon, we need to understand it, both above and below the surface. With the help of laser altimeters, high-resolution cameras, and spectral imaging, we're mapping the moon to identify safe landing zones, resource-rich environments, and suitable locations for a potential base. In fact, the Artemis missions are already identifying potential landing sites and possible locations for bases on the lunar South Pole. Considering factors such as the presence of water and minerals, slope of the terrain, availability of solar energy, continuity of communications, and potential for science. Projects like the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, launched in 2009, reflect how critical mapping is to planning any future lunar base. Once we have these maps, mining can unlock essential materials for life and construction, taking full advantage of in-situ resource utilization to reduce shipping from Earth.
All of these technologies will be shaped by one thing: the lunar supply chain, and striking a balance between taking resources with lunar resupply missions and making resources with in-situ resource utilization is essential.
The Artemis program aims to synthesize all these technologies with the ultimate goal of a lunar base by the end of the decade.
But building on the moon isn't just a technical mission, it's a legal and political one as well. The 1967 Outer Space Treaty, now signed by 115 nations as of 2025, declares the moon a shared domain of humanity. It prevents any country from claiming it as a sovereign territory. This forms the legal foundation for international cooperation on lunar exploration. Building on this, the Artemis Accords, signed by 53 countries at the time of this video, outline peaceful, transparent use of space resources. But key players are missing here. The primary stakeholders of lunar bases are national space agencies. Think NASA, Roscosmos, CNSA, and ESA. However, while some agencies like Roscosmos perform most of their activity in-house, many like NASA and CNSA subcontract projects to private companies like SpaceX or Blue Origin. At the same time, advocacy groups and think tanks like the Moon Village Association aim to influence how we think about the moon.
Ultimately, real innovation is driven by universities, where hundreds of labs work with space agencies and companies to push the research that makes lunar missions possible. They serve as incubators and hotbeds for innovation, performing research that may not yet have market feasibility, training the next generation of experts in this space, and providing an environment in which these ideas may be tried and tested. NASA funds countless competitions aimed towards attracting universities and their students to solve certain problems.
Universities are also training students in robotics, propulsion, and lunar engineering. Setting immense talent towards solving immense problems.
In shaping these students, they are also shaping the future of space itself. All these technology and policy advancements ultimately exist in the context of a larger journey, one which we are just beginning. Establishing a presence on the moon is only the first step. Already, scientists are discussing what life on Mars could look like, but none of this will be possible without a lunar base. The moon is a proving ground for life on Mars, and the infrastructure, international cooperation, and technology that we develop will be critical to any effort to reach the red planet.
For example, the Lunar Gateway space station has the potential to assist resupply and refuel missions to Mars. Additionally, ISRU technologies piloted on the moon will be even more necessary on Mars, where transfer windows will make frequent resupply more challenging than on the moon. In the grand scheme of things, this journey to the moon and Mars isn't just about resources or science. It's about the long-term survival of our species. The sun's ultimately finite lifespan means that in a billion years, Earth will be uninhabitable. It seems that in the story of our species, our doom has been pre-written. That is, if we stay terrestrial. Ultimately, a lunar base serves as an important first step to transform humanity to an interplanetary species and escape the fate of our star.
A lunar base offers hope, a place to test sustainable technologies, study deep space health, and inspire generations, potentially serving as a staging ground for life on Mars.
But it also raises difficult questions. Who owns the moon's resources? What happens when competing nations stake overlapping claims? And how do we prevent militarization?
These are all questions we pose to these young minds, our Artemis generation, that will help us return to the moon and build something that lasts, not just for one nation, but for all of us.